amazing Katie King. And she...
staff. So, you know, social media impacts all these different functions in an organisation. So for me, social media has evolved and has been about social business for quite a few years, and people are still burying their head in the sand about that. And unfortunately, this is round the corner, this is here now. So, you know, people are still getting to grips with social business, but they're having to get to grips with the Internet of Things, with machine learning, and with AI. And what do we mean by it? Put simply, we mean intelligence that's indistinguishable from that of a human being. And that isn't just a robot walking around our offices, which we might have in the future. It's virtual assistants. It's AI embedded into all kinds of apps and APIs that can be used for so many different marketing purposes. But it's here already, so I'm not talking about science fiction and Terminator movies. Of course that's there, and that's been there for quite a few years. I'm talking about, you know, voice-activated search. I'm talking about AI embedded into your Facebook, into Google, so that it can, for example, when you post a photograph, it analyses that picture and it recommends friends that you might want to tag in that picture. There's AI elements embedded into all of that. If you're like me and you like Tom Hardy and you watch one of his movies on Netflix, next time you log in, it's suggestive things. These are algorithms. We're talking about big data. We're talking about what I would call augmented intelligence. And the augmented intelligence, whether you are a doctor, whether you are a lawyer, whether you're a marketeer, AI will give you the augmented intelligence to do the aspects of your job that hopefully you'll find more interesting, and in time will take away some of that grunt work for you. So we're seeing already, you know, there's driverless cars on our roads, there's driverless trucks on many roads and being trialled in many of them. But the problem at the moment, and the reason I mention the Terminator movies and you think of robots when I say AI, is that we're at the peak. That top, up the top there, if any of you know Gartner, know their magic quadrant, know the research that they do about all kinds of new technologies. Machine learning is at the top there on that curve. And that curve is the peak of inflated expectation, which is about paranoia and it's about hype. And what we see in the press, what we heard the late Stephen Hawking talking about, what we hear Elon Musk talking about, to some extent, I wonder why they say the things they do. I think there are elements of truth in what they say, but I think they're also trying to wake us up and make us conscious about the problems that we potentially face. But coming up behind AI and machine learning are so many other technologies, and my worry is that people get bored of it before they even started to fully take advantage of it. Because we are, the light blue up here, 2 to 5 years away from getting to the point where we have loads of brilliant case studies about just how productive it is and just how wonderful it is. And in the meantime, it's going to drop down, people are going to get disillusioned. And from the research I'm doing, some people are already getting a bit disillusioned because marketeers have become like the CTO. Chief Technology Officer over here, Chief Marketing Officer over there. Marketeers for many, many years have been buying in technology platforms. They have a budget and they're very much treading on the toes of the technology people. And so with AI, they're being mandated all over the world to open up their shopping bag and buy some AI. And they're doing it in a very tactical way without any real idea of why they're doing it. They're bypassing tech, spending 30 grand on a chatbot, and it's a failure. So I'll come on in a minute and talk about, you know, a strategy for success and a framework. But you know, expectations are very high and adoption is still relatively low. There's a statistic there to back that up. So 85% believe AI will allow their companies to obtain or sustain competitive advantage. That's very impressive, but only 5% have extensively incorporated it yet. So it is still early days of AI. I think you've got a couple of years, depending on which industry you're in. So it is in many, many different industry sectors. It's in sectors where there's a lot of data. So the reason AI will take off now and in the next 5 years is we are in an AI spring or summer, having been in AI winter since around about 1945, 1950. And the reason it's now going to take off is data. So mobiles have given us more data than we can possibly cope with. And the AI is able, with all the different kind of computing power, to crunch that data, and as marketeers to give us insights. As a doctor studying oncology, you know, cancer care, as a barrister, as a lawyer, the data is being crunched at a speed that us humans can't keep up with, and it's very, very powerful. Tomorrow's biggest company, I don't mean literally tomorrow, I mean in the future, will be an education company. AI, I think, will democratise a Harvard or a Cambridge or a grammar school or a private school education for everybody. And I think that's one of the main benefits that I'm looking forward to. But in marketing, we've got tools like Wix, W-I-X, where you have AI that creates websites that build themselves. So you've got all kinds of aspects of it. But one of the big areas, you know, marketing is about customer service, it's about the customer journey. And we're going to see chatbots within 2 years accounting for 85% of all customer service. So hugely powerful from a marketing point of view, from a sales point of view, from a customer service point of view. I spoke at Oxford University, the data came out a year or so ago, and it's quite frightening on the one hand to think that AI could probably do everything we can do within just 20 or so years. That's writing an award-winning book, which I'd like to be able to do in the next, you know, when I finish it soon. You know, it's all of the things that we can do. So switch up your creative powers, make sure you hone in on the things that, you know, can't necessarily be automated in your industry and in your company, because AI will certainly be doing the automating for you in the coming years. And we're not just talking, you know, in the States, in Silicon Valley, we're talking about all over the world. So I've been out to the Middle East, as I mentioned. You know, you've got governments all over the world putting in grants, having a mandate, Theresa May speaking about it last week, you know, putting in money, putting in funding. They realise that it's really important. China and the US seem to be the two that are ahead at the moment. Emmanuel Macron in France has, you know, got his strategy ready for AI. We're starting to get ours ready as well. So there's a bit of an arms race for countries, but there will certainly be opportunities all around the world, you know, for AI to have an impact. What will it do? We're talking here on the left, increased operational efficiency. There's a lot of robotics. And certainly in the UK, our attitude to robotics is quite an industrial one. I was up at Ford and up at Land Rover, and you can see it being used there. But as a country, we're not really comfortable yet with robots in the workplace compared to, say, China. And I think that's going to change in the next few years as well. So reducing false positives, reducing operational costs. You know, at the end of the day, it does boil down to commercial reasons a lot of the time. So 79% is Capgemini saying they will implement it. It's bringing new insights and helping them to make better management decisions and making them more, ironically, you know, making them more creative as well. So as I say, it's about unlocking data. It's about, you know, you having the time. So as a law firm, you might have 20 paralegals down in your basement crunching through all of the kind of caseloads. The AI can now actually do that for them. So maybe that frees them up in a quicker period of time to get involved in more of the advocacy and more of the interesting aspects of their work. And the same with barristers. These different people, these different professions are all going to get tools, like us marketeers, that will enable them to do their job better. So there's lots of different statistics there to actually share with you. One of the biggest there, you can see 54%, is predictive analytics, and that's massive in retail. So we're talking about analysing a company, let's say a really traditional company like BT, automating loads of its processes and looking at why certain things happen, why, when the weather is as it is, do more people have outages with their internet broadband. And the AI can crunch years of that data and make sure that staff are available in their vans to go out when the weather's about to get bad. So we're talking about predictive analytics, which is partly the job of a marketeer, but we're also talking about the impact of that analytics being able to mean customer service people. which is ultimately about giving people a good service, which is what we're in business for as marketeers. So all different sectors will benefit, but the ones that have the big data, the financial services, the professional services, are the ones that really are going to benefit dramatically, very, very quickly. So we've heard a lot about Gen Z or Gen Z today. We know that it's all going onto the mobile, and here's some statistics here saying 69% agree it would be much easier if technology could speak back to them. Yeah, and 73% saying if voice assistants could understand them properly, they would use them. So I think we are moving into a world of voice-activated search, hence my question earlier, and also ambient voice, where we're no longer walking along, speaking into our phone, but actually speaking out there into a kind of a wider assistant, maybe holograms and so on. So maybe that will make us more human as well. So AI has a lot of scaremongering, like I mentioned. If any of you have any time to read, I would recommend a book called Life 3.0 by Max Tegmark, who's a professor at MIT. And he's outlined here, and I've taken this from his book, some of the myths about AI. Myths like superintelligence is just years away. Actually, it's potentially decades away. We're waiting on quantum computing. We're waiting on probably 30 plus years where AI really is sentient and has that consciousness and can really compete with the human. In the meantime, AI-embedded apps, robotics, machine learning will be able to do many of the things that we will be able to do in the next 5, in the next 10 years, but still many years away from that true super artificial intelligence. There's a worry that AI will turn evil. The fact is, with all kinds of previous technologies, with genome sequencing, with nuclear, if it gets into the wrong hands, any new developments can be a real danger. So actually, AI turning competent with goals that are misaligned to our goals is more of a worry. And there are many more of those that I would like to share with you. One of the big problems at the moment is that I call him, and I am obviously female, but I am of his age, Mr. Pale Male Stale. Any of you have heard me speak before? Yeah? Mr. Pale Male Stale, he's white, he's middle class, he's grey-haired, he's over 50. Now, I have lots of things in common with him, apart from being female. But many people at the head of companies in all different industry sectors are certainly going to struggle with Snapchat and Instagram, and they're very, very anxious about AI. And many of the people at the helm of these organisations really are feeling very uncomfortable about these changes. So we've got here, only small percentages of leaders at the moment feel ready to manage a workforce with AI, virtual assistants, as well as normal human staff. And yet you've got bigger numbers that are actually, trying to sort of start buying AI. So I think we're going to see some people of a certain age having to go through a major shift of being outside of their comfort zone. But equally, I speak to people in their 20s and they don't really understand AI and they're frightened by AI. So actually it's about your mindset and not about your age. So I'm not going to be ageist. So more myths to put to bed. And again, a new report might come out later today which might kind of take this to another level. But at the moment, one of the most recent reports I've seen is this one by Gartner that talks about AI will eliminate 1.8 million jobs, but will actually create more jobs. So there's going to be a net gain. But the truth is, nobody really knows. We don't really know until industries really start to take it on board, the real impact that it's going to have. But I can understand why people are worried. And if you've got, I've got daughters of kind of 18, 22, so it's slightly different for them. If you've got younger kids, or like me, you're thinking ahead to maybe having grandchildren, nieces, nephews, in 15 years, they'll be doing jobs that haven't even been invented yet. But then chief digital officers, there are so many job titles that have been created in recent years, before Snapchat and other tools were invented, and it's going to be the same with AI. So, we are looking at a different world with different jobs, with different norms and different ethics. And for me, these are some of the big implications. So I don't want you to go away only thinking of doom and gloom, job losses, and you know, robot warfare, and terminators. It's not about that. It's much, much bigger than that, deeper than that. But there are some implications. It would be wrong of me not to give you a bit of a reality check, because there are some. One is the black box. God, how sick are we all of GDPR emails? You know, it's just been an onslaught of GDPR. But with GDPR, it's really important that there is transparency and that people know steps that are being taken and why decisions are being made. And actually, this might hold AI back a little bit. So I'm calling it the black box syndrome. So if AI is used by an insurance company or a bank, and the data that they crunch, whether it's based on postcodes, whether it's based on defaulting on mortgages, whether it's based on whatever historic data they've got, if that then tells, the AI does that number crunching and then basically flags up, don't give that person their mortgage, don't give her a bank account. Okay? From a GDPR perspective and from new legislation, it's really important that we understand how that decision's been raised. And actually, part of the problem with AI is that we might not be fully up to speed with why the decision is being reached. So there's implications like that to consider. Any Black Mirror fans in the room? Yeah? Anyone see the episode? Social scoring episode? It's coming true. So, you know, China ranking its citizens with a social credit system was really similar to one of the episodes that featured on Black Mirror, a Netflix series. And what we're actually seeing, they actually set up this social credit system and announced it 4 years ago, and it's actually coming in and going to be fully operational in less than 2 years' time. And this is scoring people on their social credit, and if they don't have high scores, stopping them from buying products, from going on planes. This is not something I'm advocating, and I don't think in the UK we would allow this to happen. We would be marching up to 10 Downing Street, we would be protesting in the streets, we would be protesting over social media, but it is happening in parts in China. So here you go. Being banned from flying or getting on a train, that was reported in Channel News Asia. So that to me is not a good use of these kinds of new technologies. But at the same time, you know, we do need to be aware that with machine learning and with the potential of quantum computing, machines will be able to teach themselves, machine to machine learning. So the potential for robot warfare, of course, is there, but I believe there is still time. What worries me at the moment is the frameworks, the ethics, cross-global legal jurisdictions, and are not yet fully in place. So I'm a bit anxious about that, but I think people like Elon Musk and the late Stephen Hawking, I think, make a noise about it because they do want to shake people up. And I'm talking to academics who are collaborating with other academics globally. Policymakers are starting to get onto it. You know, social media, the law can't even keep up with social media. You know, people put Poppy on Facebook on Remembrance Sunday and say, you squaddy C-U-N-T's, and, you know, people get arrested. But people are struggling in the law to keep up with social media. Can you imagine how they're struggling to keep up with developments like this? So you often see the legal system in catch-up mode. But certainly in the UK, I'm listening in to the Lords Select Committee, and they're bringing in the top advisors from every discipline, and you know, it's quite impressive what they are actually talking about. But it is a worry. So how can you prepare? Being here today, learning, reading, you don't have to do a course in it. You don't have to. I'm not pretending to be a technologist who knows how to code in TensorFlow or Python. That's not what I'm about. My book is about the use of AI in marketing. It's more about strategy. It's going to show case studies. It's going to talk about ethics and all these things. But you will have people in your organisation who could probably be retrained to do this and to you know, to learn about it, or you will buy in the right expertise, and you will buy in consultancy, or you will develop your own people to understand and buy my book, maybe. You know, so there will be many, many different people that are part of your kind of puzzle of how you go about adapting to it. But like I said a few moments ago, one of the biggest is a mindset that is open to change, a mindset that realises that the world is changing, that marketing is going through a renaissance, that the business landscape is being fundamentally disrupted. So that's the key, is the mindset. Whether you're in HR, whether you're in marketing, you know, this impacts all of you. The next is you have to have clear goals. You know, I heard some impressive stuff earlier about influencers and, you know, Snapchat, and it's brilliant. And those, you know, those kind of platforms really have a role, and those people have a role. But without a clear idea of who your customers are, where you're heading as an organisation, what your competitors are up to, what the changes are in your sector, you know, they become vanity metrics. So with anything, it is about having a clear goal, having a clear strategy, and not being controlled by other people, because you need to control your own agenda. You don't just go with your bag open and say, I want to buy some AI, or I've got to be agile. You need to understand what within your business and within your sector are the trends and what are the tasks that could be automated and things that AI can do for you as a marketeer, whether that's email marketing, whether it's getting the right subject heading so you don't churn clients, whether it's using a virtual assistant as a member of your team to actually help you with a chatbot style, web bot, you know, so you can actually do customer service, whether it's a website that builds itself in AI, whether it's predictive analytics, all those things I'm mentioning are about marketing. But they're not robots walking down around your office, they're all the different ways it can be used. So, again, I think marketing is going to change in the coming years, and some people will be in the tech camp, in the programmatic camp, and the others will be in the creative camp. And I think you need to align yourself with one of those, and you need to be constantly thinking about which of your skills, you know, can be future-proofed and what you need to learn. So, you know, thinking about what kind of organisation are you, what kind of industry are you working in, but also funding. You know, where is the funding going to come from? In order to get the right funding, do you need to collaborate? Do you need to partner? So some of the things to look out for, you've got Adobe Sensei, you've got IBM Watson. Within IBM Watson, you've got multiple APIs for all different aspects of marketing. You can buy those. You can develop your own proprietary AI in TensorFlow, in Python. You can hire, if you're lucky, because they're in huge demand, somebody with a PhD in cognitive science or data science or AI. Or you can develop some of your existing technology. So all of these are, you know, aspects of getting prepared to be AI ready. But I think the thing is not to be scared of it. It's not going to change overnight. Things take a little bit of time, but you know, it's in our personal worlds. It's creeping into our business worlds. If you go onto IBM Watson, you can see loads of brilliant case studies of how it's being used in oncology care, like I mentioned, in healthcare, in banks, in building societies, and across many, many other sectors. So it is there, it's happening, it's probably two or so years away, maybe five, from being really mainstream in some sectors. And, you know, maybe, I mean, Stephen Hawking talked about having to go and colonise other planets because he felt that the robots would ultimately take over the Earth. I'm not sure I agree with that, but I think while we still have the time, we need to put the effort into the frameworks, into, it's been described as maybe having a Hippocratic Oath. When you become a doctor, signing that Hippocratic Oath, maybe those training and developing and coding in AI need to sign up to a set of guidelines for ethics, a I think those aspects are really important, just as they were when we wanted to avoid Frankenstein with genome sequencing and Dolly the Sheep and all of those. So sometimes the scaremongering is necessary to make people put the frameworks to success, you know, in properly. So that's a whistle-stop tour of AI. I really need a day to take you into all of the industry sectors and a bit more about the technology. But I wanted to allow five, six minutes for any questions if anybody has any. So thank you very much for that. Does anyone have any observations or any questions? On here? I can just repeat it if you don't want to hear. How can you all hear that? So how many years or months are we away from social media consultants being able to use it? The truth is, so it depends who you service. So let's say you're a social media consultant to big banks, okay? There might be banks that are already using it and the kind of marketing they do and whether they're using Salesforce or whether they need to be seen or really have the budget to be doing that using all of the tools. Or if you're using it for a small and medium-sized business in, where I'm based in Kent. So it kind of depends who you do the work for, which industry sector, and the appetite in that sector for this, and whether other people have yet cottoned onto it. But the truth is, there already are tools that have AI embedded into them that may not even call itself AI. You know, Salesforce, Einstein, there are many, many social media tools that already have AI, where the AI writes the blogs and the AI writes the content. So actually, there are other people that may be using AI-embedded tools, but there'll be hundreds and thousands of clients that still want the human being. But at the same time as a few years ago, even 2 years ago, I had people really sceptical about social media. Okay, now they all realise they have to be on it, and that's why there are so many of us. But people are like that with AI now. So there were many, many, many clients who for quite a few years to come will be the laggards, and they will bury their heads in the sand, and there will be work for social media people for years and years to come. So it's about how ambitious are you, and how do you want to future-proof yourself, and who are you servicing? Do you see what I mean? So there's people progress at different stages. So Gartner talks about laggards, traditionalists, and those that are disruptive. If you want to be a disruptor in social media, you've got to keep staying ahead of the game. And maybe one way to do it is to do what you do already and also use a few tools that, you know, are out there to be used. Maybe go and develop your own with some funding. So it's actually not a straightforward answer. It kind of depends where you or your clients want to be, who they want to partner with, how technologically savvy they are. But you know, don't be sweet, you've got plenty of time. There's still people doing very, very traditional marketing. And you know, there's farmers in Kent who still don't even have websites. You know, they still have marketing experts that might maybe develop posters for them. And, you know, there's going to be people that progress at different stages. But yeah, good question.
Hi, I'm Kathleen, nice to meet you. So my question is really about the digital inequality that I perceive that AI will bring, but I was interested in your talk. You mentioned that you saw it as being a leveling of the playing field for our children's generation and AI coming to schools, whereas everything I've read, I'm obviously not as expert as you, but from what I've seen, for instance, Facebook putting in, you know, a few million dollars to their community boost program to enhance digital skills in America compared to them investing the kind of billion that there's in their Canada AI sector, their French AI sector. So there seems to be a big disparity in terms of investment from the Googles and the Facebooks who are progressing, who are the champions of this technology. And I don't see how, like you say, the government moves ridiculously slowly and appear to have no idea that this is even happening. So I don't see how the jobs that are going to be created in AI, obviously they will be, are going to level that playing field. I believe it's going to create a massively unequal world where it is only those who have come from intense privilege, like all of us in the room today, who listen to talks like you and are able to upskill ourselves and think, oh, hang on, AI is coming. But, you know,
it's such a complex thing, you're right, and the truth again is we don't know. And, you know, what our government does, because if you think about it, I think there will be a period of underemployment and unemployment before some of those new jobs kick in. So potentially, and one thing being discussed in certain countries in Scandinavia is a living wage. So if we have huge job losses as a result of this, then there will be mass unrest. So, you know, we live in a democracy, and I think, you know, if our government wants to quell any potential future issues and anarchy and unrest, then there will need to be a bit of a levelling out of the playing field. But you're absolutely right when you talk about the companies that they call them gaffer, yeah? Google, Apple, Facebook, Amazon, throw Microsoft into the mix and you've got what are called the Frightful Five. So these five companies dominate, and these five companies are bigger and more powerful than many countries, and bigger and more powerful than many governments. And the scandal with Cambridge Analytica and the fact that social media has given us a voice in recent years should, and thinking back to the Arab Spring movement and change and what have you, we should be able to have a voice, and we should be able to put pressure on those companies and on those countries to get some equality. And from some of my interviews with some amazing brands, I believe there's going to be a shift in the power to the consumer away from the brand in the coming years. And hopefully, us consumers will want to work only with really ethical brands. So I think we have a voice and we have a say. And you know, I'd like to think, I don't mean it with a rose-tinted glasses kind of way, but you know, the technology capabilities of AI mean something like Coursera. Imagine a portal like a learning management system that could teach anyone a degree in AI, using AI and other blended learning. In theory, that could be used to democratise education. But as you say, the reality might be that that gets powered by people, and you know, they put a cost against it, which makes it unacceptable, and you know, makes it elitist again. So I think, you know, we still do live in a very elitist society, and the power isn't with the right people at the moment. So, like you, I do worry about that. I worry that that's possible, and I am hopeful that the humanity will prevail. But, you know, the truth is we don't know.
Any more questions?
With my best friend Alexa, that has all the answers for everything, we still need education.
Yes, we will. I think we will. You know, I do a lot of training. We learn in peer groups. We learn very well from one another. I think, you know, Alexa and voice-activated tools and AI-embedded apps will be used in the classroom extensively and in the training room extensively going forward. But I think we still need social groupings, and I think teachers and lecturers and you know, all kinds of college assistants, there's still going to be those roles for people, but the curriculum will need to change, and I think we will increasingly draw on those kinds of tools. It's changing when we learn, definitely. There was a question at the back. Sorry, if we have time for one more.
Oh, we've got time for another one.
I mean, the truth, you know, if things, we may slow down the pace of change. We may actually, as governments, because of lack of funding or lack of availability of the data scientists or lack of appetite by certain industry sectors, it might slow down. We might actually see it happening at a slower pace. But, you know, that the predictions are that it's set to kind of progress quite quickly.
Any more questions?
One of the questions I've got is, we're looking at a company like Uber at the moment who's taking over the market, providing taxi service. Ultimately, their game is to get rid of the drivers and have driverless cars and through the use of AI. What does the world look like in the next 50 years with AI, and what will happen to humans?
Some people believe we're evolving into AI. Some people believe that the AI, there's going to be a chapter in my book called The Paradox of Personalization, because everything from personalized medicine and all kinds of personalized marketing, which is what we're doing, is made possible by AI. So my mum had to travel in quite a way on the bus recently because her, you know, her branch in her area is closed, of her bank. And, you know, we're seeing kind of the high street changing. So I think we're seeing more and more technology, but again, with the way jobs will change and a period of underemployment and maybe more focus on ethical companies, we might have more leisure time and do different kind of work. But AI and technology will certainly, you know, Internet of Things, sensors, holograms, these will be part of our world. But maybe we will spend less time on the grunt work and working 8 to 6 and, you know, crazy hours. Maybe we'll have a more human style of life. I don't know. But, you know, industries have been disrupted, you know, with technology and the Industrial Revolution. This is called the Fourth Industrial Revolution. So steam, electrification and computing are what have come before. And we adapted and we changed. You know, we thought planes were going to fall out of the sky. You know, we didn't want the internet. I started to work 28 years ago. We didn't have the internet. It's radically changed our world. You know, I interviewed a professor yesterday who's writing a thesis on how voice with ambient voice, when you speak it out rather than all being crunched up over our phones, may free us up again to communicate with one another better. And that actually we'll come out of this phase and into a more human phase. So the robot will maybe do more of our human grunt work, and maybe we'll get a bit more time to do more interesting, strategic, fun, creative things. That's a bit of a utopia, but that's maybe part of it.
That'd be nice, wouldn't it?
It would be nice. Let's end on a high note.
Thank you so much, Katie. That was amazing.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
What we can do now is we can carry on the conversation down at the pub. So just round the road, on the back of these programmes, it tells you that the drinks are going to start at 6, but they can start now. We've got drinks for you. All you have to do is bring a badge to get drinks, and then we can talk about the future and all of the wonderful things that are in store. And then we'll see you here tomorrow, again, bright and early for the workshops. There'll be more people here as well. The reception opens at about 8:30 a.m. and the first talk is Instagram and